Good morning, all of you, and welcome to another day of this course on excellence in leadership. And this morning, we have one among the who is who of Bangalore and India, Sri Mohandas Pai, to speak to us. We are very grateful to him to have found time to come here and share his ideas on excellence and on the importance of leadership to you. Dr. P.K. Shetty is the moderator and observer for today's sessions. He will be with you. He will be leading the sessions. So let me first introduce Dr. P.K. Shetty to you. Dr. P.K. Shetty is a fellow in the School of Natural Sciences and Engineering. He obtained his PhD from the Indian Agricultural Research Institute. His current research interests are in the areas of natural resource conservation, environmental toxicology, ecosystem governance, eco-informatics, and agroecology. Dr. Shetty has carried out both experimental and field-based research on important areas related to environment and agriculture. He has co-edited two books and published several research papers and articles. He has collaborated on research projects with leading science institutions in India, including Indian Institute of Science, Bhabha Atomic Research Center, and Indian Agriculture Research Institute. He has been elected as Vice President, Society of Pesticide Science, India. He has been associated with many government and non-governmental organizations working in the field of environment and society. Dr. P.K. Shetty.
Dr. Sangeeta, Dr. Kasturi Rangan, participants of this course, faculty, it gives me immense pleasure to introduce Mr. Mohandas Pai, currently CFO and Director, Infosys Technologies Limited. Sri Mohandas Pai has been with Infosys for over 11 years. At Infosys, he is responsible for the financial integrity of the business, from sourcing capital to investment in the various business, evaluating performance and ensuring returns. Mr. Pai has been instrumental in enabling the listing of Infosys in the Nasdaq and thereafter conducting a sponsored secondary offering, both of which were first in India, and instituting an employee's stock option schemes, which is another first in the country. Mr. Pai also participates in several committees that drives industry policy and practices. His efforts have resulted in the issue of employee stock options regulation, improved accounting practices, and corporate governance regulations in India. As CFO, he has several credits, including winning the first CFO of the Year award instituted by the EIU and MX, and Best CFO in India award from Finance Asia, and Best Presented Annual Report award of the ICAI for 10 years running. He is a chartered accountant with ranks at the All India level in both the inter and final exams, a Bachelor of Commerce and a Bachelor of Law. He also has a keen interest in primary education and citizen activities. He is currently working with Akshaya Foundation on a midday meal program to feed over 85,000 children in government schools in Bangalore, rural and urban areas, in Mathura, Hubli, Jaipur, etc., with an aim to feed 10 lakh children daily by 2010. May I now request Mr. Pai to deliver his talk.
Folks, thank you for this opportunity. It is great to be amongst senior people and talk to them and share some views about matters in which you have a personal interest. For quite some time in Infosys, we have been engaged in looking at leadership issues. We underwent a study for the Malcolm Baldrige Award for Quality in the United States to look at how good we are compared to global majors. And one result of the study was that we were told that we need to have a formal process of generating leaders. We were told that the big seminal issue in the 21st century is going to be the war for talent and the question of leadership. Leaders are going to determine how companies fail and succeed, how nations fail and succeed, how organizations can succeed. So we have set in place a formal process of training people to be leaders. We have set in place a formal process of understanding the leadership issue. And we do think that going through this formal process will make us much better and richer. So when I was asked to come and talk today, I said, let me talk on the topic of the importance of leadership. Because if you look around the world today and look at countries which have succeeded and countries which have failed, the key challenge that countries who have failed face is that of leadership. We always take the example of Lee Kuan Yew of Singapore. How is it that a very small island with no resources, with nothing in its favor, with a chaotic workforce, with a very indisciplined population, was within a generation able to become a first world nation? There is no parallel in human history. Then we look at China. How is it that a nation with a civilizational record of 5,000 years able to transform itself and become today the second most powerful nation in the world, well on its way to becoming the largest and the most powerful nation on this planet, all in the space of possibly 30, 35 years. 20, 25 years ago, India and China were similar in terms of per capita income, in terms of economic growth. But today, China is so far ahead. The Chinese economy is 2.5 times the size of the Indian economy, and the growth impetus in China will drive it forward at 10% a year, possibly for the next decade. I would urge all of you to visit China to see for yourself what a nation with determined leadership could do. Yes, when you look at China, you get the standard replies about democracy, about totalitarian governments, and about the fact that decision-making is concentrated. These are all true. At the same time, what the Chinese have done in terms of educating the population, in terms of making proper investments in infrastructure, in terms of governance, has been out of the ordinary. India does have a democracy, and the democracy is a wonderful thing. It works very well, and I think we do need a democracy. But the challenge we have faced in the country has essentially been the challenge of leadership. Have we had the leaders to take us on the journey to unleash the creative talent of our people? We ended up creating a system which stifled the creative talent of people. When I look at the public sector, I get this view more and more, because I do think that the public sector has the best talented, most talented people in this country. The best minds, the brightest minds join the public sector and public service. And once they join the public sector and the public service, the freedom to operate was not given to them. The freedom to grow, the freedom to operate, the freedom to do great things and to dream. And unless individuals in a democracy have this freedom, which is their birthright and which is very important, we shall certainly miss the bus. Anyway, that's a very personal opinion, so let me start on this technical talk today. Peter Drucker gave a very interesting definition of leadership to say, the only definition of a leader is someone who has followers. A leader is not an island in himself or herself. A leader requires followers. And followers come behind a leader because they have something to receive, something to aspire for, and they believe that the leader will deliver to them in ample quantity. Why do soldiers follow a charismatic leader in battle when they know that they're going to lose their lives? They follow it because the leader demonstrates to them a concept, a vision of glory in the battlefield, a vision of saving the country, or whatever, which is larger than all of them. And it is this vision that he inculcates, or he or she inculcates, in the people who lead. So, a leader is someone who has followers. John Maxwell says, leadership is influence. How do you make sure that the people who lead are sufficiently induced to follow you? How do you influence them? Mentally, spiritually, and by a very physical presence. We see it very often in society that when some people or leaders come by, people stand up and talk to them, not because of the position they have, but because the sheer respect that they have for that person. Physical appearances could be extremely deceptive. For example, you had Mahatma Gandhi, a puny little figure, but everywhere Gandhi walked, everywhere Gandhi talked, millions of people followed. And what did this man have? Nothing but moral courage. So he had the ability to influence, he had the ability to think beyond, he had the ability to inculcate something in people. And Warren Bennis said that leadership is a function of knowing yourself, having a vision that is communicated, building trust, etc. It's a very business definition which all of us know of. There is another view of leadership, and that's called the heroic view of leadership, and that's true in human history. Every time there's been a crisis in many countries, there has emerged from within the country a person to take people out. And that is there in old civilizations. Old civilizations look for messiahs, look for people who come as leaders. The Buddha came as a leader to deliver his people from a very oppressive social system. Shankara came as a leader in India to bring back Hinduism into the mainstream. And after that, we have had leaders like Gandhi, who came and led his people to freedom. So people believe in this heroic concept that leaders emerge when there are times of great crises. Leaders emerge when things coalesce to a point when they need to lead. We've seen it in some way in Poland when Lech Walesa came together and he stood up one day when the shipyard had a strike and he delivered a talk to his people. He suddenly became a leader and became the focal point of dissent against an oppressive socialistic system. So this heroic aspect of leadership also delves into a very important point that followers should be prepared to have leaders. Followers should be prepared sufficiently to say that we will follow somebody who will lead us and get us to a better life. In modern times, does the heroic concept work? I think it does. It does primarily because in social groups, people feel oppressed. People feel the need for change. People feel the need to do something very different to raise their lives. And then they look for somebody who can lead them. Very often, the somebody who leads them gets attributes much greater than what they possess and what they have. And in case they do that, for a limited period of time, they are taken as leaders. And then once you achieve that the thing that you wanted, you are all jettisoned. They don't sustain themselves as leaders. They fall by the wayside. In business, do you have this heroic concept? To some extent, yes. Because if you look at startup organizations or smaller organizations, you know, if an organization has to grow and to become great, their leader should have this heroic aspect in his or her personality. Because that's the only way you can enthuse people to come and join together to work under you for a common vision and to carry on despite privation and despite having a circumstance which is not very conducive for many people. Because you need to get out of the comfort zone in case you got to do that. And this is one view of leaders. And I think at the back of our mind, if we understand this and if we become leaders, we have to capitalize on this aspect because it's a very emotional view of leadership. How do people become leaders? What is it in us that makes us some leaders? Well, I think there are some people whom we call natural leaders. And we see it very often. When we are children, we always play under a captain, right? We always have somebody who comes and says, let's play together, and we listen to them and we go with them, and there is something that attaches us to them. So there's a natural trait. It happens in life. Some people come up and take leadership because leadership is never given. In most organizations and most societies, leadership is taken. Somebody comes and makes a point, and somebody has the courage to push it forward, and somebody gets accepted, and you become a leader. So a leader has to be outgoing. A leader should be a great communicator. A leader should have that extra energy to say that they will do something extraordinary. Another event which could make a leader is called the great events theory, which fits in well with the heroic theory, which says that when some events happen in a particular way, that event itself creates leaders. It could be a crisis in society. It could be an event of extraordinary difference, and people look for somebody who can solve the problem because people do hope for deliverance. At the back of our mind in society, I think we all think that we need somebody to deliver. In India, we find that in a different way now that, you know, people want somebody to come and become a leader and change the context and make us very much richer and better as people. You know, in the middle class, we do get frustrated at the corruption, at the wrong things that happen, and we look for somebody who's going to deliver us. But the great events theory works in very peculiar circumstances, in great crises. It doesn't work in normal times. Then the other theory says transformational leadership theory, which talks about how people can choose to be leaders. It says that people can learn leadership skills, and leadership is a process. And for those of us in business, we like to go by this theory, because while we in business cannot hopefully create great leaders from everybody, we can create leaders in the context in which people are, to imbibe in them those qualities which will make them much better in leading groups of people in achieving business objectives. So a process-based leadership program could work under this theory of the transformational leadership theory. It is widely accepted in human resources area today to say that people can be taught to be leaders, and people can be educated how to be leaders, and we can bring in behavioral aspects of leadership. And this is something that's engaging global corporations in a very big way today. There's a small story. The story says that a young boy has just got his driving permit, and he went to his father and wanted to drive his car. And his father says that, look, if you do well in your school, I'll give you the car, and maybe I'll do it for you. And I think we heard this before, right? We go to parents when we're kids and we tell them that we want something. They say, you go study and I'll give you something as a reward. Now, after some time, this boy goes to his father and shows him his father's grades. And the father is very proud and says, the grades are up, but you didn't get your hair cut. And he gives a logical explanation that I didn't get my hair cut because people had long hair. And then the father says that, yeah, they all had long hair, leaders had long hair, but they walked everywhere they went and didn't go by a car. Now, what is the story behind this? The story behind this is that people who want to be great are great because of the way they are, and it's not because of the way something is forced on them. They become great despite themselves. They have an innate ability within themselves to become great. And we see it in all the leaders that we have. And if you look at the lives of the greatest leaders throughout history, particularly Mahatma Gandhi, one thing comes out: a leader leads by example. In a battlefield, you can't be a leader if you run away from battle. You can't be a general if you stay at the background and ask your soldiers to march to the death. It's not going to happen. It'll happen in the limited context that people will march to the death because they are disciplined people, but you will not be a great leader. People always like to see a leader lead the people. Take the example of Alexander. 300 years before the birth, before we started measuring by this new measure, in 300 BC, Alexander was a young person in Macedonia. The Greek states looked down upon Alexander, and Alexander had something special in him. He was taught by Aristotle. He got educated, and he wanted to go and conquer the world. And those days, Macedonia was a small city, a city-state, maybe a larger area than a city. But he went and conquered the greatest empire the world has known, the Persian Empire, and he came to India and conquered many states in India. And he led by example. He fought in the battle, so he could enthuse his soldiers for many, many years to follow him and do something different. Gandhi also did the same. Gandhi never asked anybody to do anything which Gandhi did not want to himself. When Rajiv Gandhi addressed the joint session of US Congress some years ago, he gave a story about Gandhi. It appears that when Gandhi was working, a mother came to him and said, Gandhiji, please talk to my son and ask him not to eat too much sweets. It's not good for his health. He doesn't listen to me. So Gandhi told the lady to come back after 15 days. And after 15 days, when she came back, Gandhi told her son not to eat, and the son obeyed. And she asked him, why did you asked me to come out 15 days, you could have done it the same day. He said, look, I spend the next 15 days not eating sweets, just to find out what it means. How does it impact me? How does it affect me? Because how can I tell somebody to do something which I'm not willing to do? Now, this is an important thing. This is a personality trait. All great leaders will first do something themselves and then ask their followers to do it. But if you do that, there is credibility. So leaders need to build credibility. If you're a business leader, you have to walk the talk. If you tell your people to cut costs, to work harder, you got to do that. In Infosys, Narayan Murthy used to come to office at 6:30 in the morning. Oh, he was a terrible guy. He still is. But he used to leave at 8:30 for many years, because he had this feeling that as a leader, he has to be first to come and the last to go. Stuff on his personal life. But he built a culture in Infosys where all of us accept the demands of leadership and all of us demonstrate that in our lives. And it makes for a very different organization. I think in all organizations, the leaders themselves do not walk the talk. They have a very comfortable life and they ask others to do something very much different. People are not going to accept it. People are very smart. They look up for signals. They look up for something different from the leaders. And I think this is a very important thing. In our core values for Infosys, leadership by example is a core value. And we are all asked to practice leadership by example. I'll give an instance. This year we're going to hire 20,000 people. Hiring 20,000 people is not easy. I think every working day, you got to hire about maybe 80 to 100 people. And it's a tough call. You got to get these people from colleges, from outside, inculcate them, train them, and develop a value system. People ask us, how do you create a value system in all these new people? In the last 3 years, we have grown from about 15,000 people to 50,000 people. And we have lost about 10,000 people in the bargain. That means about 45,000 people have come in. Now, how do you create a value system? The only way you can do a value system is by education and by walking the talk. Because they look up to you as leaders to practice the value system that you profess. And if you practice that value system, then it percolates down. But if you happen to be a leader who doesn't practice but mouths it, then nobody's going to listen to you. It's not going to work. Because people are very smart and they look up to people for signals. Gandhi did a very important thing to demonstrate to his people how what they should do. First, he dressed and lived as the people in this country lived. He dressed and lived. He had a loincloth. He went bare-chested. He had a stick and he walked. He walked and he walked. He spoke to them in the language they understand, very simply. And he went to all the villages. After, I think, the Buddha and the Shankara, Gandhi was the only person who probably spent an enormous amount of time going through the country. And he could communicate. And they remember Gandhi. And he was one of them. Because he connected with the great mass of people, not only the educated elite. Remember, at the time of the freedom movement, the leadership came from the educated elite. The leadership didn't come from the masses. The educated elite were probably 1%, 2%. And we see it in India today, that leadership does not come from the educated elite. Leadership comes from the great masses. And we in the middle class are slightly upset about it because we can't relate to these leaders. We can't relate to them because they're not one of us. But the great mass of people in this country are different. And they relate to people. So we talk about a Lalu Prasad Yadav and we make fun of him. But Lalu is a great leader. He won the elections for many years. We may not like him. That's okay. It's a democracy. But the fact remains, he could communicate. He was the aspiration for the people. He delivered a lot of people from an oppressive social system. So leaders walk the talk, demonstrate, and their lives become inspiration. So Gandhi, by the way he did that. The second trait he did was to have tremendous amount of moral courage. He fought a political battle. Because moral courage is important for a leader. Because leadership is a slippery slope. The moment you slip and you compromise yourself, you're gone. Because people may respect you because you hold a position, but they'll not respect you as an individual, as a leader. So the moment you compromise on any of your values and show people some kind of a compromise, it is gone. We had an occasion in Infosys where one member of the board got into a sexual harassment matter. Within 2 minutes, the chairman decided he has to go. And the person who went was a future leader of the company. The company had made tremendous investment on them. But it is against the value system and he had to go. There was no debate. There was no discussion. He had to go. Because you can't compromise on something very fundamental to you, whatever be the cost. And that, I think, is an important attribute. And Gandhi taught that. Gandhi taught by sheer moral force that you can oppose the greatest empire the world has seen and you can do it without raising your hand. If you take up a gun and fight against somebody, it requires a little bit of courage. But to stand before an oppressive power, unarmed, and to say, do your worst and be prepared to give up a life, it requires indomitable courage. Something totally extraordinary. And Gandhi's view was that he could imbibe that passion among ordinary people, housewives who stayed in the house in Parada, who could march on the street and stand before the guns of the British and tell them, do your worst. Now, what is this magic? The magic came because they saw him as a leader. Now, in business, what is this context? For all of us, what is this context? The context is simple. Leadership is painful. It's extremely painful. If you want to be leaders, we must take the pain. Leadership is being alone. Leadership is making no compromises. No compromises. Life is not a compromise if you want to be a leader. You can't compromise on values. You can't compromise on the essential qualities that make you. And you have to walk alone. Leadership is lonely. And leadership means that you listen to everybody, but at the end of the day, you take responsibility for the consequences of your action. And you don't pass the buck. And if you look at great people, we learn all this. And life has gone on. Look at Abraham Lincoln. Lincoln had another facet of leadership. Lincoln failed many times. He failed in business, failed in the coming to the assembly, failed in business again, had a nervous breakdown, defeated for speakership, defeated again for presidential electorate, defeated again for US Congress. I mean, he was defeated many times. But what made him a great leader? A perseverant spirit, perseverance. Leadership is all about perseverance. Leadership is about banging your head against the wall, against all obstacles, and bringing the wall down. Leadership is about falling up in the ground and trying new things and getting up and fighting. Now look at cricket. I'm very fond of this. I mean, if I upset you, it's okay. I look at Rahul Dravid and look at Ganguly. Ganguly is a great charismatic leader. He gave spirit to India. Indians are very dispirited on the cricket field. He gave spirit to India. He led India. But he has some negative traits. You know, very feudal in nature. Nepotism develops cliques. And even though he was courageous, it is sad to see your captain become the bunny for every young wannabe all over the world. To think that every young fast bowler can go bounce at him and know this guy will get out. You know, you feel dispirited. And look at Dravid. Very professional, very cool, very merit-oriented, extremely secure. As a leader, we have to be secure. We have to have belief in ourselves. And leading by example, he went out on the first test in fading light to open the innings. Now that is a matter of courage. As a matter of setting the tone. Now he's set. You can't disclose the man. He's a different class. He had it in him all the time. And he said that he is going to do. And if you look at Dravid's life, he has failed several times, but always come back because he had the perseverance. So if you look at Ganguly, you look at Dravid, you see the traits of leadership and what the differences are. Because the leader has to imbibe confidence in the led. And the confidence can come only if you lead by example. And Lincoln had this great quality of perseverance. Even though he failed, he always came back. And he was courageous. He took decisions. And finally, he succeeded. And I think the success has got to do a lot with the way his personality was. He had nothing. Born in the log cabin or whatever it is, we hear all the stories. But at the same time, he had that personal courage and stuff in him to persevere despite everything else. Look at Nelson Mandela. Mandela was a product of the modern age. And Mandela had a value system which was instilled in him by his family. And he became one of the most influential leaders. Mandela led his people out of apartheid and slavery, but did in a very non-violent way. And after he became president, he set up the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, just to make sure that people take their angst out, their anger out, and get it recorded and put it behind them. But he forgave everybody. So Mandela led by his values. He didn't compromise on his values. He went to jail for many years. He led by his values. So living by the values is an important trait of leadership. Leading by example, having perseverance, taking failure in your stride, and carrying on regardless, and making sure that you have a value system is something that we need to look at. Napoleon. What is it with Napoleon that set him apart from from everybody else. The story told about a general who came and told him about his famous victory and went on talking about it. Napoleon listened politely, and after he stopped talking, Napoleon asked him, what do you do the next day after the battle? Now, what is the message here? The message is very clear. A leader never rests on his laurels. Life is all about tomorrow. Today is dead. Today is gone. The past is history. And you know, it's a very personal thing. When I was 45, you know, a couple of, 2-3 years ago, it suddenly struck me, personally, that I have less to live than what I've been through. So every day that I live, it slips, life slips through your fingers. Because you got lesser days. And it struck to me that make the most of it. You're not going to get it back. Because when you're very young, it doesn't matter. Mortality is not a very big thing on the radar screen. But as you cross the age of 40, 45, it one day it hits you. Maybe I don't know, but you know, it hits all of us. That you've got less to live than you've been through, and every day is important. So when you do that, you only think about the future. The past is dead. The moment you do, past is there. No arguments about the past. So when you talk to your wife, I know you don't talk about the old quarrels and all the things that you did. Just forget about it. Talk about today and tomorrow. And make the most of it. Make the most impact on your surroundings, because you're not going to get it back. And Napoleon demonstrated that. That yesterday's battle is history. Tomorrow's battle is all that matters. So for leaders, leaders have to look to the future. They can't rest on their glory, on their laurels to say that I have done many things. Now I'm going to be a leader for life. There's nothing like a leader for life. Look at the animal world. I'm fascinated by wolf packs. The wolf packs have many young wolves constantly looking at the leader, because the leader is, you know, the male, the alpha wolf is the one that leads the pack, who gets, you know, who mates with all the females. And that's a very important thing, because that's nature. You want to carry on. And then there are these young uppity guys who go for the leader. And every time the uppity guys keep looking at this guy and say, the moment this guy shows some weakness in the hunt, shows a lack of energy, a slight weakness, keeps his eye away, go for him and go for the kill. So leadership is about tomorrow. Leadership is not about yesterday. You could have been a great hero yesterday, but tomorrow if you don't perform, if you're not there, you're gone. It's very tenuous. That means you have to be practice leadership every single moment. And if you don't do that, you're gone. And that's a difficult thing to do. In business, does it matter? To some extent, yes. Because in business, if you fail as a leader or demonstrate some weakness, the decline starts. Time for it to go. Sunil Gavaskar made that famous statement that you must go when people ask why rather than why not. And you must go with a flag high with trumpets blaring, in a blaze of glory. So people remember you as the person who changed stuff, changed matters, not as a pathetic creature who lead past his prime. And that's important, because human beings cling on to positions. They cling on, they want it. Because you know, leadership is like an aphrodisiac. It gives you a kick. You get that exhilaration of power. You feel powerful. People respect you. But it's a difficult thing to give it away. And a good leader always gives it away. We had the case in Infosys. At the age of 55, Narayan Murthy stepped down as CEO and gave it to our current CEO, Nandan Nilekani. It was a terrible thing for him, because, you know, he's a powerful man. You know, he built this corporation. It's a very unique company. But he stepped down because he said, I worked till 60. I retired at 60. And I got 5 years to make sure that the CEO runs this company well. So I'm going to hand it over. And he went step back. And one thing he did to make sure that the memories in the organization of a charismatic leader don't impinge upon the capacity of a new leader to take stride, he's traveled out. He spends 80% of his time outside India. Now, what is the message? The message is clearly he wanted change. He's going to be around to make sure it works. And he'll fade away. But he went at a time of his choosing, not when people ask, do you have the energy to continue? I think that's an important thing for a leader. Because you want to be remembered as a leader for the very strong person who led change, who changed the context, not as a person who retired past his prime. And look at all the leaders you think about in our lives. And when we remember them, what do we remember? Very few of them went when they had to go. Most of them were pushed out. It is indeed pathetic. In the organizational context, what does it mean to business organizations? Well, if you look at the failure of corporations in modern business today, you find a very unique thing. And what is that? You find that business corporations fail because of a lack of leadership, not because of a lack of capital, because capital is available to great leaders and to good businesses. But if you don't have leadership, you cannot succeed. A leader needs to strategize. So in business too, leadership is the key differentiator between corporations which succeed and corporations do not. The organization issue that challenge tomorrow's leaders. Life is going to be very competitive. Life is going to be very different. Life is going to be about a war for talent. Life is going to see an acceleration of technology trends. And therefore, people need to keep current. And life is going to see greater regulatory constraints as society progresses. A new thing we're seeing in business and in our lives today is the rise of the so-called civil society. Rise of people outside the formal systems who come together and who demand that they be heard despite having sometimes no legitimacy to be heard. But that's the nature of the beast. And this is a trend that's going to impact everybody who runs organizations in a very formal way. And these people have the ability to change legislation, to change regulations, and to make sure that they can impinge upon your business by bringing in many things. In the last WTO, they tried to bring in labor standards against the emerging markets. And this created a different context. They march in the streets in Seattle. They march in the streets in Hong Kong against globalization. But whatever it is, the leader has to constantly adjust strategy, constantly make sure that that they're very dynamic to change the context in a business way. Why are leaders important? Can we do without leaders? Think about it. Can we do without leaders? Can we rule by committee? Very appealing idea. Okay, leadership means single person. Committee means many people. Committee means shared responsibilities, shared accountability. Can we do that? Well, very, very difficult. Nobody has succeeded ruling by committee. You can develop consensus, but the leader has to take the decision. Leaders are required because leaders need to give direction. In business, what is the new business to follow? Look at the example of General Electric. We see it as an icon. I mean, I talk about companies in the global context because we are a global company. So please forgive me if I don't talk in the Indian context in a very different way because we see things very differently. We get 98% of our revenues from outside India. So, you know, it's a different thing for us. So if you look at GE, what made GE succeed? A business is a collection, is a portfolio. Leadership is constant. A business is a portfolio. The aim of the leader is to grow business and sell businesses. The only thing that you marry is your wife, hopefully, and stay married. All businesses are to be bought and sold to trade because no business is a profitable business for very long. And if you get stuck with a business for very long, you're gone. Look at the Sensex, the stock market index for India. Look at the companies that formed the Sensex about 10 years ago. Look at the companies who formed the Sensex today. There's a sea change. In the Dow Jones index in New York, for the last 100 years, only one company has remained constant. All the 30 companies that make up the Dow Jones index are gone. Only one company has remained constant. And why is that? Only one company has remained constant. It could be serendipity. It could be great strategy. But if you look at that company that's remained constant, you find a very unique thing. The company has constantly changed business. In business theory, the biggest question people ask is why do companies become mortal? Why are companies mortal? Why are business organizations mortal? Studies have proven that even though business organizations have perpetual succession, our legal entities could survive for a long period of time, most of them die in middle age at 30 to 40. And why is that? Because the business that they are in ceases to be profitable or becomes more competitive or commoditized, and they just can't make the change. So business entities do die. Very few grow to be 100, very few go to be 75, and very few go to be 200 or 300. There's no recorded instance of listed companies which are more than 150 years old. They all die. In America today, AT&T is gone. AT&T was the largest, most valuable company in the world 30 years ago, is gone. It's dead. And you see, all great organizations which we heard when we were growing up, they're all gone. The brand names are gone. The new company in the block is Google. Google, a small, uppity company, just a search engine, but it's worth $150 billion. And look at India. You have Infosys, which is worth about $16-17 billion, came from nowhere. You had giant companies in India which grew up, which have huge assets, but declining. Why is that? Because there is change. The key thing in society is that there are change. So we need leaders to manage to times of change and give a sense of directions. Leaders make things happen. That's an important context. You got to be dynamic and you got to be creative and you got to change the context. And only leaders can do that, because all of us get into the comfort of the womb. We all become comfortable in what we do. And as we get older and become more comfortable, we don't want change, because change forces us to react very differently. And we don't like to do that. So inertia sets in, and inertia sets the direction. So in old organizations, very often, you need to change. We try to do it. We are growing 30% a year. And our biggest challenge has been that the stars of yesterday are not the stars of today. People who we thought are leaders yesterday are just unable to cope with the pace of change, and they don't become the leaders of tomorrow. The mortality rate in leaders is extremely high. So when organizations grow up, they change the context. People who are leaders and who made things happen are unable to grow mentally to react to the new circumstances, and that makes an enormous difference. Leaders are revolutionaries. And so this is a very nice concept. Why are they revolutionaries? Leaders are innate rebels. You know, one of the fascinating things that you see in the world today is young people in colleges are becoming status quo, it's not rebels. Young people have no ideology. Look at our post-war history. Every time there's a change, it's the student community which brought about change. 1977 in India, the students who brought about change after the emergency, brought the emergency down, right? Where are those students today? Where are those young people today who are ideologues, who have an ideology? Well, some of them in JNU do have an ideology, but JNU is gone. You know why? All the MNCs are hiring all the students from JNU. There are going to be no young people left to become ideologues and to become socialists in India. Probably the country will be better off. But nevertheless, the important thing is that leaders should be rebels. Because a rebel has enormous energy. A rebel has an innate passion for change. And a rebel can change the context. And if you're not rebels, you don't fight the status quo. The status quo overwhelms you. Society is about atrophy. Society is about stratification. Society is about inertia. Because the pace of change in nature is extremely, extremely slow. The only thing that can change the pace of change is an enormous amount of energy, is a rebellious nature of a human being. And that rebellious nature shows up when one is young. So leaders are revolutionaries in a very particular way. Leadership is about getting ordinary people to do extraordinary things. Couple of examples. Kapil Dev's innings in the World Cup in 1983. Nobody expected India to win. India won, and Kapil Dev led from the front. Greece and Portugal in the last World Cup, in the Euro 2004, Greece had never won a match in a major tournament. As a team of underclass, they created history. Now, the nine faces of leadership, what are the traits? Charisma. Do leaders need charisma? Well, yes. Leaders need charisma. Something different that set them apart. Something that makes people follow. Can you develop charisma? I don't know whether you can develop charisma. Charisma is just the way that you are. It's a persona. It's part of a persona. So leaders need charisma. If leaders are very dull, it's difficult. Yesterday I had a group of visitors come, and we're talking about the American elections, and there were two ladies, and they told us they don't like Hillary Clinton to be a leader of the US. I asked why, and they said that, look, she's dull and boring. And I said, do you like Clinton? He said, yeah, we like Clinton. But what can Hillary do like Clinton to make life more exciting? Well, they were laughing about it. But nevertheless, you need charisma in a leader. Can you have a dull, boring leader? I don't want to use this word, but you know, we do have a lot of them, and you know, they're not inspiring. So you need a little bit of charisma. An individual consideration, a sense of individuality, a sense of reaching out to every single individual. Leaders have the capacity to make every individual important. If you walk into somebody's chamber and talk to them for a few minutes, some people have the innate ability to make you feel extremely important and make you feel as if you're the most important person in the world till you go out and they forget your name. They can't remember your names. But for that moment, you feel important. So an ability to reach out to an individual. Intellectual stimulation. Since a leader can change the context, leadership is an attribute by which you stimulate the capability of various people who deal with you to talk about something very different. So leadership is an intellectual challenge. An intellectual challenge because you need change. And change can come only when you are intellectually capable of analyzing change and coming out with a rationale for change. Courage. I think on courage we have a consensus. Because unless you have courage, you cannot change. And courage to take unpopular decisions at the time that you think that others are not going to stand by you. And the only way you can take decisions is to make sure that you accept responsibility. Dependability, keeping commitments, credibility. A leader should have credibility. A leader makes a promise, the promise should be followed up with action. Because the leader doesn't keep the promise, you're not going to trust the leader. And that's the problem with Clinton, because Americans say that Clinton lied when they asked about something else. He told a lie. Nobody, and those people don't like people to lie. But then the cultural things come in. Just think about it. In India, leaders lie all the time. All of us accept it. We don't think they're honest. So we are very sure what they are. So our expectations of a leader is well limited. In Japan, they lie to the teeth. They lie to the teeth. So, you know, the concept of leadership is also a concept of cultural capabilities in various countries. So we need to look at our own culture to find out what is it that we look for as an attribute to leaders. In India, what do we accept? Do we accept that leaders have to be honest? Leaders should have integrity? Leaders should have commitment? I don't know. It's something that we need to debate as to what our expectations of leaders are. But one thing I think we all accept in business and organizations is that a leader should not play favorites. A leader should not follow nepotism. A leader should give a sense of direction. Integrity, judgment, a leader should have the capacity to make sound judgment and respect for others. Leadership types. Entrepreneurs, a leader should be an entrepreneur, should have the capacity to look at things in a very different way, starting from ground up. A leader should be a strategist, an ability to make a choice and to give a sense of direction. A leader should be a change driver, a change agent. A leader should be a global thinker. Why should leaders, business leaders, be global thinkers today? Why can't we be very local? Let me give you some traits as to what is happening globally. There are three big forces working around the world to bring about change today. First is globalization, the creation of a single market for goods and services, reduction of tariff barriers, reduction of the barriers to the movement of natural persons, the shrinkage of distance, and interconnectivity between people and businesses. So globalization is going to be a great driver and a leverer for us going forward in future, and we cannot wish away globalization. We need to open our markets like the other countries open their markets and allow free trade to prosper. So all of us should be geared up to face globalization. The second important thing that's driving the world today is demographic transition. The demographic content of various countries is changing. The whole of Europe is coming to a level below replacement rate. The population is aging. In Germany, you have three young people to make sure the pension of a retired person is paid. By 2020, you'll have two young people, and that's going to create a challenge because pensions are paid on a pay-as-you-earn basis. Japan, last year, had 33,000 lesser men than the year before. The population is shrinking. Men are dying faster. They're working harder and they've got other challenges. But there are lesser men in Japan today than they were a year ago. And the projection is that by maybe 50, 60 years, the population will shrink by 50%. women are not bearing children. The reproductive rate is 1.2888, number stuck in my mind, per woman. You need to have 2.1 children per woman to make sure the population stays stable. In Japan, it's 1.288. Women marry at 35, they want careers because women are not treated very well in the society. It's a very feudal society internally, and they got a challenge. And Japan's population may shrink. The number of people who pass 60 is already about 25%. And look at the United States, growing by 1.5%, largely by immigration. By 2050, Hispanics will be the largest part of the population in the US. The Anglo-Saxons will be in a minority. Hispanics, Spanish will become the official language, hopefully. So it's going to change. It's not going to be an Anglo-Saxon world anymore. England, Asians make up 13% of the population. What does that mean? The colonial experience coming home. I had a very funny experience. I was meeting a fund manager from England in Connecticut about 3 years ago, and I asked him, what are you doing here in the US? He said, you know, you guys, we ruled you for 200 years. I don't be ruled by you for 200 years, so I went to the US. It's a very funny thing. There are a lot more Asians in England than they were earlier, and the Asians are more virile, and you know, the population is growing, more fertile. And that part of the population is growing very well. So if you look around the world, you see this demographic transition changing, and that's going to change the way we work in India. In India, we have a young population. 60% of the population is less than the age of 30. 450 million people less than the age of 20. And we read in economics that when the population, the working population becomes a larger part of the total population, growth takes off. Growth takes off. The dependency ratio is coming down. When young people work today, they don't have to support their siblings, their family, or their parents. They can spend all the money. So consumerism takes off. A larger part of the salary is saved. Our salary or income is saved, is spent. There are lesser people depending upon one working person. And that drives the economic growth rates. So we are at a sweet spot for the next 25 years. The only challenge we face the country in the sweet spot is the fact that while we have a young population, we are undergoing the demographic transition, the young population doesn't have the skills to capitalize for a long period of time. If you look at what happened in the last 10 years of liberalization and globalization in India, you find a very unique thing. 200 million people who are educated are doing very well, getting good jobs, making good money, having a better quality of life. The 800 million are left behind. Why? Because when you open the economy, opportunities abound, but people with skills get the opportunities. So unless you drive skills down and make the bottom layer skill, they're not going to participate. And they're going to be the majority in our democracy. And that's a challenge. So this is going to drive things in future. The third important thing that's happening in the world is the fact that nationalities are creating economic blocks rather than countries. Let me give you an example. The Jewish community, even though there may be 7 to 8 million around the world, have an economic impact which is possibly equal to the third or fourth largest country in the world. They control so much of assets. The overseas Chinese are 50 million, responsible for 65% of FDI into China. And they probably have an economic clout of close to $2 trillion. The overseas Indians, 20 million of them, have an economic size larger than the GDP of India. So all those who flew over the cuckoo's nest and got away from the orbit of India have done very well. And the message here. So in future, in the next 80 years, we're going to see the interlinking of nationalities and possibly the decline of the nation state because of consolidation. And these nationalities are going to have larger and larger economic power, and the network impact is going to create its own challenges in terms of power. What does it mean to us in India, in business, in organizations? It means many things. In the next 10 years in India, we're going to see an explosion of growth. Our GDP will double. Go from 800 billion to 1.6 trillion if you grow at 7%. We can grow at 7% easily, despite the government. And 10 years later after that, we can still double because it's still an emerging market. If you go to 3.2 trillion, we're going to add 2.8 billion, 2.4 billion in the next 20 years, in our lifetime. This country is going to be different. The challenges we face are going to be different. And for all of you in this room, in the next 10 years, if you're in business or in organizations, the challenges are going to be immensely much more different. the situation is going to be much more dynamic. The demands on you are going to be that much greater. And none of the experience of the past could possibly help us. We need to change our way of thinking to get ready for the growth in case we want to stay in the positions that where we are. And India is changed. And for that, we need to have strategy. So leaders should be a talent advocate, an enterprise guardian. So a leader has to be a people leader, an operational leader, and a strategic leader. What are the dilemmas that you face if you're a leader? Some of the dilemmas that you face are, as a leader, do you have a broad-based leadership team, or are you a loner? What kind of leadership do you prepare? Look at Gandhi again. It's a very interesting thought. Gandhi created the largest pool of leaders this country has seen in politics. When Gandhi left, this country was very rich in leadership. When his successor Nehru left, this country was very poor in leadership. What is the essential difference? The essential difference was that Gandhi, being a very secure person, created leaders, inspired people to follow. But of course, the context was different. The context of the freedom struggle, you had a common enemy. And Gandhi had a very collegial, open way of leadership. He accepted many people coming, and he debated with them, he discussed with them. After independence, it became almost like a lone ranger battle, and the educated people never went into politics. A leadership team was never created. And that is impacting this country today. And it impacts in organizations too. You see some organizations which have a bench of leaders, because the leadership style is create the next generation of leaders and many more leaders, you have a bench. You have organizations which have high visibility leaders. A single leader who's charismatic, goes out to the world, but after he goes, what happens to the organization? So this is essentially a leadership trait. Independence versus interdependence, Scott drew the first one. Long-term versus short-term is a dilemma leaders face. Do you invest for the long-term? Do you try to meet your short-term objectives and greater glory? How do you balance one against the other? And for those of you in government and in the public sector, this is a very key thing. Because you are judged by the short term, but you need to invest for the long term. And long term calls for a different kind of orientation. But you have to survive the long term to go to the short term to go to the long term. And this is indeed very difficult. Creativity versus discipline is a leadership trait. Do you instill creativity within your enterprise? Allow dissent? A great leader, I believe, allows dissent. Allows people to talk their mind and to be free and to dissent. Dissent is perfectly fine. Adherence to the leader is not necessary. If followers have the right to dissent, you create greater leadership teams, because the right to dissent is a very important attribute for a leader to have in his followers, because the right to dissent creates new points of view. And the right of dissent also imbibes a sense of freedom, of independence in the followers. That's an important trait. Trust versus change. Do you scheme as a leader, or do you create a bridge of trust? Is an important dilemma that you face. Bureaucracy busting versus economies of scale. This is very particular for business. People versus productivity. Can a leader be heartless within an organization, not look out for the people interest, go after profits, and keep profit maximization the goal, rather than people development? It's a dilemma that you have to face. Revenue growth versus cost containment. These are some things that came out in a study on leadership with a share. It is not easy. Leadership is not easy. Leadership is extremely difficult. Leadership is very challenging. But it can only be mitigated by the fact that the leader gets much more in the form of a satisfaction, and the leader has changed the context, and the leader has brought in something very much new. Because I think as human beings, we always want change. And I think the change is something that drives. Look at this example. You know, Walt Disney was a very charismatic person who created the Walt Disney Company, one of the greatest media companies the world has seen. And Walt was a very creative person. After he died, unfortunately, did not create a next generation of leaders. So the company spent a decade or two wondering what the leader would have done, what the past leader would have done in the circumstance, and trying to come out with an answer to business dilemmas and business issues. So an organization dominated by charismatic leadership is not sustainable. It's like a firefly. Brings light and goes away. There's a beautiful poem which my friend told me one day, which talks about charisma and how charismatic leaders are. And I quote, "My candle burns at both ends. It will not last the night. My candle burns at both ends. It will not last the night. But oh my friends and oh my foes, it doth give a beautiful light." Charismatic leaders burn at both ends. They give a beautiful light when they last. But after that is darkness, because there are no more candles being lit. And leadership is all about lighting many more small candles to create greater light. In the future, the real core competence of companies will be the ability to continuously and creatively destroy and remake themselves to meet customer demands. We come back to the ancient Indian theory of creative destruction. Destruction, sustenance, creation, sustenance, destruction. In business too, we have to do that. So the leader creates, sustains, destroys. As a leader, you must have the capacity to destroy. Destroy in a very positive way. Because if you carry on with the past practices and don't change, you are doomed. You are doomed. You stratify and you do not change. I think you've seen this quote. You've seen this quote about growing people, so I'll just skip that. Now, I'm trying to make a case for a formal process of leadership development. Because as we leave this room, we need to have something to take away with us in our own organizations to practice. People are shifting jobs. And I think it's good to shift jobs. All of us should shift at least 2 or 3 jobs in our lives. I think it's very important. I think it's very important primarily because beyond within a particular organization, we tend to, reach to the maximum that we can do, and we get stuck, and we get comfortable. And if you get comfortable, you can't develop yourself, you can't realize your potential. So unless you go from organization to organization, but not changing organization every 2 years, but probably changing one every 7 years or 10 years, the 7 year itch. I mean, Somnath is there, in Infosys I head HR, so I'm not going to make the statement within Infosys. Somnath is from HR. But I think it's an important thing for all of us to see. Should we stick in the same place for 30 years, 25 years, or should we change? I don't know the answer, but I think all of us should find out, because if we want to be true leaders, we need to change. And why is it that we need to produce leaders and have a process? There's going to be intense competition for individuals capable of leading complex business organizations. When our economy is going to double in 10 years, the next 10 years, and the odds are in the favor, there's going to be that much more opportunity available for leaders. All new businesses want leaders. Today, the biggest shortage in India is about leaders for business. Companies don't have enough CEOs. Companies don't have enough leaders. And I think that's going to be a big challenge going forward, and the challenge is only going to get worse. Things are going to become much more competitive and complex, and when there's competitiveness and complexity, leadership challenges become that much more important. Career growth emphasizing on leadership skill rather than technical skills are industry knowledge. Hitherto we have seen an economy where specialist skills were much sought, but in future leadership skills are going to become that much more effective. Another trend that we are seeing is emergence of the global leader. With globalization, the leadership traits are going to change. We have to have the attributes of what we call the global leader. What is a global leader? A global leader is a person who can demonstrate leadership traits in any part of the world that you jettison them in. It basically means that you have a common set of traits, because leadership traits are common. They're cultural differences. Cultural differences are overlay. So you can go to any culture, you can imbibe the culture, but you have the capacity to be a leader across. And especially for people like us, creating global leaders is becoming a challenge. And as business globalizes, people find that don't have enough people who can become global leaders. And this is the challenge for organizations in the 21st century. The story, I'll skip the story because, we're running short of time. As you go up the ladder within the organization, and as you globalize much more, cultural differences become much more important. You've seen that ad of HSBC, think local and act global. They're talking, giving ads about, you know, various cultural practices and saying people who can understand the nuance of culture can do that. For example, France, you've got to learn how to drink wine. If a teetotaler, you're going to be in trouble. Learn how to eat French food, because when you talk to the French, these things are extremely important. They think the unique way of life is based upon a gastronomic way of thinking, and that becomes extremely important. If you go to the Japanese, very hierarchical, very, very obedient, very slow decision-making process. And if you happen to be one of those tearaway leaders, you're not going to succeed. Leadership styles: autocratic, paternalistic, participative, delegative, free-range style. There are different styles, different ways of doing it, and I think we have experienced some of it in our lives. Which is best and what is necessary, I don't have an answer. But going forward, the lack of good leaders is going to be a barrier for growth. Look at these companies. All these companies are not doing well. Ericsson went down, is coming back. Burger King is gone. Coca-Cola is now going through change and not able to compete. Two-thirds of the world's companies have changed CEOs at least once in the last 5 years, because they're not succeeded. They've not been able to compete. And this is going to be a challenge. Organizations are investing in corporate universities. We also have our Leadership Institute. And the Leadership Institute is doing good work. And we have three types of leadership and a formal process of leadership. Will we succeed? I don't know. But we certainly improve the context and improve the qualitative differences in people who want to become leaders. Great organizations are built to last. At the end of the day, for business and organization, mortality is a reality. How do we extend the period when mortality becomes a reality? And you can only do that by having great leaders and having a process for leaders. Leadership is about being bold, daring, and unconventional. If you look at this, do you know what this is? Just think of this picture. These look like sticks, right? These are diodes which can emit light and which can project. So you have a projection system by using these components, and you can make presentations. So you have one of them, it will display the light, and if you fix it up next to your keyboard, you can make presentations. So thank you very much for this discussion. And if you have any questions now, I'll be happy to answer them.
Thank you, Mr. Pai. It was a brilliant talk on the importance of leadership. Now we will open up for a few questions. Yes, please.
Very thought-provoking lecture. I just want to ask you, because you talked about Napoleon, instead of decorating the marshal, he wanted to know what is going to happen next tomorrow. So how do we draw a line between a good leader and an over-ambitious leader?
I think the very statement, over-ambitious, is a value judgment. I don't know who can make that value judgment, because you can make it with the hindsight, but at that point of time, what is over-ambition? I don't know. Because who is to draw a line?
Why I'm asking is, like, suppose whatever the vision of the leader, it should be feasible. Like telling the things which are not possible and then forcing the subordinates to work on that. Maybe you may be calling yourself a good leader, but may not be possible in the real sense.
Well, maybe it is necessary to do that. I don't know. It may be necessary to do that, because how do you bring about change? How do you ensure survival? Because a leader may be seeing something happening in the horizon which is going to hurt the organization. And the only way to do that is to force change. Because in many organizations, you have severe restrictions on your capability to bring in change. But if you are committed to your organization, you have to force change, and you have to do that. So, you see, most business organizations have checks and balances, like a leader, a CEO, and a board, and there are checks and balances. So I don't think there is any organization where an individual can do whatever he wants and become crazy. That's a very, very extreme case. Yeah.
In fact, thank you very much for a very lucid and exhaustive talk on the subject of leadership. I am from the army, where we are faced with different challenges in as far as leadership goes. In a way, we are all appointed leaders when we choose this profession. After that starts the day to prove it. From that day onwards, till date, we are busy always proving that yes, we are worth the position given to us. The challenges are totally different. But the nature of challenge remains the same, what you have projected. One small question I have to ask you. In the context of a business empire, like Infosys or any other, and in the context of a nation, though the leadership traits would all appear to be the same, you mentioned about changing, switching jobs, like for a leader himself to change his organization, which perhaps may not be possible for a national leader to do. But even within a business community, business empire, there must be a better alternative than changing the job. Rather, by becoming a patriarch, you create a organizational hierarchy like the Chinese do in their government. Being a single party, they're able to do it. Every 10 years, visibly, one new set of leaders take charge, but the guidelines remain the same. The roadmap remains the same. Similarly, a system can be worked out for a successful company like Infosys, rather than leaders quitting in between. You can have a hierarchical way of training leaders, testing them, positioning them. Like you yourself said, your mentor had allowed the leadership change even in a prime youth when he still very much has the energy to continue. Same thing can be done rather than you looking for other jobs. How this dichotomy will challenge us?
You made a very important point, but the answer is that the dynamic conditions that prevail in societies, in government, in organizing that you represent, organize we represent are different. For us, the external environment is extremely dynamic. Extremely dynamic. For you, in the armed forces, it is dynamic, but at a slower pace of change. In the government, it's still slower because society changes very slowly. While a Lee Kuan Yew can change Singapore in a lifetime, to change India in a lifetime takes an enormous amount of energy. It's difficult. So I think we have to find solutions within the context of what we are and the environment that we face. But the traits are the same, the need is the same, the pace of change varies. But even look at China. China is, economically so very different from India. The pace of change is so rapid. But pace of change in the society is not so rapid. In the political system is not so rapid. In the social structures is not so rapid. Right? So in economic activity is very rapid. Well, I think so. If you break up the environment into different parts and see which can change rapidly, which can change slower, we can make it work. We don't have to be stuck to a particular roadmap. But the roadmap can change. For example, look at the American army. They become much more leaner, much more technology oriented, right? And they're shrinking their army much more. Whereas China is also shrinking. India is trying to shrink to become more technology savvy, because in future warfare is going to be electronic. Warfare is going to be from remote areas. You're not going to have soldiers facing each other to the same extent that you did earlier. So the context is changing. So you can make the change. Some evolve slower, some evolve faster. What is the right pace? The leader has to determine. Yes, sir.
Who has been your role model and why?
For me?
Yes.
Murthy.
But that's a pretty obvious answer.
No, for me, my role model has been Gandhi in the larger context. Mahatma Gandhi. Because of a very important reason. His life was not too far away. I mean, I never saw him. I mean, I grew up much later than he died. But the key thing is, what the man stood for in this context as to live in this country. The more you read about him, the more you understand him, you see how he acted, and it becomes a role model. So to me, in my personal life, Gandhi is a role model. And in business life, Murthy is a role model. I mean, in business, I studied many people in India and abroad, but Murthy was very real. Yeah.
Sir, thank you for a very brilliant presentation. Actually, the topic that we have discussed today, centrally concerns legitimacy. The moment we are talking about leadership, we are questioning was coined by Max Weber, a German, who talked about, you know, charismatic authority, then ancient authority, you know, the hierarchical feudal systems are there, and finally legal authority, where you have a democratic system. In the present day context, you know, of the global economy, as you are saying, one particular market, one single market, or let us take any OMI's borderless countries, or algorithmic markets, where, you know, you have interlinked economy, ideally as we described. In such a scenario, you know, it is always appropriate to look at leadership from the, you know, linguistic point of power and solidarity angle. You know, no matter what the context is, today in the present context, you know, leading large number of people, groups of people in different countries, would it not be appropriate, I would seek your opinion, to, you know, veer towards the solidarity angle rather than the power angle? Or the angle, you know, of authority, exercising authority, controlling people. A shift from there to solidarity. Because in a certain way, you know, you have also suggested that when Gandhi was there, you know, he was moving towards solidarity.
Yeah, but you know, the question is, how much time do you have? Solidarity is very, very difficult to build up in a short period of time. Because solidarity ensures that you change the minds of people to working in a very unified way. Because they want to do it. They want to do it. And that's very, very difficult. It could be more long-term, more sustaining. But then, again, nothing is permanent. See, for a country, it's okay. For a political system, is okay. For a business organization, solidarity may not be very important in a way, because if you spend your time on creating solidarity, you come up to a point and then you need to change again, and then it's going to be difficult. So, is there one single answer? There's no single answer.
You would recommend combining?
Well, I would recommend effective leadership. There are attributes, there are many things. You pick and choose the right portfolio for you to become a leader in the context that you are in. Is there one single way? There's no single way. There's no single way. There's no single mega solution. Saying that if we all practice one thing, we'll all be a different thing. It's not going to work.
Srivastav?
Yeah.
You have a question? Srivastav?
Okay. Yes, sir.
It seems to me that corporate India has done a fairly good job of developing leaders. On the other hand, the governance in the country is quite poor. Is there any way to transfer leadership into the government sector?
Well, I think the first thing required in any form of leadership is meritocracy. The best people should become leaders. Who are the best people? The people who can perform, people who have made a difference, people who have the energy. So you've got to create a context where the best people become leaders in society. If you don't do that, you're not going to have good governance. That's one. And two, you have to create a system which is focused on results. Which is focused on results, very clearly on results. A result-oriented culture. That's two. Three, you have to create appropriate incentives. Human beings react to incentives. You have to incentivize people, either through power, to status, or through anything else. In the government system, status may be important. Because we respect people who are in public service. But today we are debased status. So when you debase the status, why should good people want to get into public service? So, I think to bring about change in governance in this country, I don't know, it's an extremely difficult task. I am firmly of the opinion that we must force our government to get out of many areas and let loose the creative energies of our people. That's the only solution to this country. We must ask the government to step down from many areas, whittle away all the unnecessary things that do, concentrate on the areas that they have to do, law and order, defense, currency, infrastructure, policy. Period. Then I think we're all better off as a people. Otherwise, it's gone. This is a no-end direction. For example, I work with Mr. Vijay Bhaskar, an extraordinary individual. He has changed the entire education scheme, the schooling system in the state. He's one of the type in this country. Extraordinary person, his passion, his commitment, his capacity to understand, to create the focus, create the energy, create the vision is unbelievable. If he's there in for 10 years more and given the total freedom, this state is totally different. But is he going to be there? Is he going to get the freedom? I don't know. I only pray that he does so. And you find these examples. You find these examples many places. But we have to make it systemic. And today, you ask any bright young person, the top 20%, how many of them want to join the government service? Why is that? The aspiration is because you're not creating an environment where people can come in. Even public sector. Because, you know, public sector is a great legacy. We have the best people in the country in the public sector. The private sector is not a patch of the public sector. But in the next 20 years, it's going to be different. It's going to be totally different because the context in the last 10 years have changed. Yeah. Yes, sir.
In your presentation, you mentioned about, you know, the future leadership. Less on technological skills and more on the other aspects. Now, where does the technology leaders fit in here? Is it not required?
No, we'll need technology leaders. But for organizations, can organization be run by pure technological leaders? That's the question to ask. We need leaders in technology. But for organization at the overall level, if you have an organization leader, should he be pure technology? It'll work to a limited extent. But then, specialization is becoming the rule of life. Right? And if a business leader happens to be a pure technologist, I don't know whether he can get over his capacity and capability to be fascinated by technology and look at other issues. I don't know. That's why the statement is there. Yes, sir.
Just go.
You had mentioned that an institute has been set up for leadership in the Infosys. What sort of student base population do you have, the faculty, the syllabus, the courses in this institute?
Well, we believe that the business is the course, the faculty are the leaders, and the campus is the company. So our business is the course. We teach them what we do and why we do things, and the strategies about our business and what inputs go in. So that's the curriculum. The students are the senior leaders. We have broken up the company into three tiers of leadership, the tier one, tier two, tier three. The tier one are people who are leaders below the board. They're mentored by the board members, and the board members take classes for them. We invite outside experts to come. We send them to other institutions for training. And the second level is mentored by the first level, and they also undergo training within the organization. So by creating a structured process, we are enabling the growth of these people to become future leaders. So it is substantially inside the organization and partly outside. And partly outside because the external stimulus in our organization is very, very high. It's a global business. The external stimulus is extremely high. So we don't have to put too much into the external point of view.
Are there any other questions? If there are no other questions, may I now request...
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Rashmi Rao to present a lot of points, please. It was brilliant.
Thank you, sir. It was a very thought-provoking talk, and I'm sure all of us are going to be benefited, because when we go back and we reflect upon ourselves, we can really improve in terms of what we learned today. I thank you on behalf of all the participants and on my own behalf for coming here, giving your valuable time and knowledge and enlightening us on the importance of leadership. Thank you, sir.
Sir, Dr. Sangeeta Menon, coordinator of this course, to present a momentum on behalf of Institute to Mohandas Pai.
Mr. Mohandas Pai, it was such an excellent, excellent lecture, not just on leadership, but on effective leadership. And your main ideas of the importance of transformational leadership was reminding me of a concept in our tradition, how a sannyasi creates and gives up, and then he transcends what he gives up. Thank you so much for having your time here and spending this very important time with all of us. It's a small moment.
Thank you very much.
It's a very good time.
Yeah, I think he's got the presentation.